jammed up in the mass of vehicles that were crowding the invasion beaches. This, though, was only the start of the When, at last, the tanks managed to move in land, they found that the Normandy countryside seemed to be conspiring against them. The blockade, or box country, close to Caen, certainly lived up to its name, with its secondary of small fields surrounded by hedgerows and narrow, twisted lanes. The Allied troops had been trained for fast, mobile warfare, but now found themselves embroiled in destructive terrain, which slowed their progress. They had allowed the bulk of the German army to move into place and block the way to Caen. From there, the Germans proceeded to put up a ferocious defense that started the Allies. It seemed impossible for the Germans to resist in such strength and with such vigor that this made sense. At sea, the time when German U-boats had terrorized the Atlantic coast. At home, German war industries had been heavily bombed, and their capacity so severely reduced that production could no longer keep pace, and often suffered on the fighting front. The much vaunted Luftwaffe, which rode the skies of continental Europe virtually unchallenged early on in the war, had become a part of its former glory. After the Battle of Britain in 1940, when it failed to support the RAF, the first modern airborne carrier, the Luftwaffe was never the same again. In Russia, there were early successes, but too much Luftwaffe strength was later bled away in combat with the improving Russian air force. By the end of the Roman advance, a mere 400 aircraft were all the Luftwaffe could bring to the battle, against 30,000 men, Allied fighters and bombers. Also, Allied bombing was anything but an intervention, as well as losses in the air, the Luftwaffe was effectively neutralized. After the day, the occasional Luftwaffe squadron, 50 aircraft or so, made its appearance in the skies over Normandy. It was the Allies who held the advantage that most mattered, taking command of the air. The year 1942 had already prefigured the ultimate fate of the German war effort. The surrender of General Paulus and his decimated Sixth Army at Stalingrad had been a crippling psychological as well as military blow. Stalingrad proved to be the first step in the inexorable withdrawal that saw the Germans pushed out of Russia into Poland and over Germany's eastern border. The prestigious African Corps suffered final defeat in North Africa. From there, the Allies went on to conquer Sicily. Next, they invaded Italy, which surrendered at once and went over to the Allied side. The Germans had known all along that one day the Allies would assault Adolf Hitler's fortress Europe. Keeping them out had been the purpose of the mighty Atlantic War, which stretched along the north and west coasts of France, down to the Spanish border. But where would they strike? An Allied campaign of deception, suggesting invasion sites in Norway, central Italy, the Eastern Mediterranean, the Pas de Calais, and elsewhere in France, had left the Germans so thoroughly confused that they did not know for certain where to expect their attack until the Allied invasion fleet appeared off the Normandy coast. Once the Allies reached the shore and started moving off the beaches, the importance of Caen came into focus. Lying on the left bank of the river, southwest of Laon, Caen was at one and the same time a vital linchpin of the German defences and a crucial target of the Allies. The only town among the myriad villages in the heart of France, Caen dominated the undulating plains on which it grew and was the hub of 12 major roads and a vital railway system. If they could hold Caen, the Germans had the chance to confine the invaders close to the Normandy beaches and then throw them back into the English Channel. On the other hand, if the Allies could take Caen, the way would be open to the rest of Europe and eastwards into Nazi territory itself. No two ways about it. The fight for Caen was going to be make or break for both sides. Already by the end of D-Day, the Allied commandos in charge of capturing Caen had been shown what a difficult task it was going to be. In theory, it might have been even more difficult because the two men in overall command, US General Dwight D. Eisenhower, Supreme Allied Commander in Europe, and the British General Bernard Montgomery, Commander of the 21st Army Group, were such totally different candidates. The fact that Eisenhower and Montgomery managed to work together was a tribute to the Americans' extraordinary tact and forbearance. As was rather overemphasized at the time, Eisenhower was a desk general, an organizer and a strategist, rather than a warrior. He spent his career in relative obscurity. Yet in 1942, he was chosen out of 336 other senior officers as the candidate best suited to place in overall command of the Allied invasion of Europe. Eisenhower was to need all his powers to mollify, mediate, and persuade when it came to dealing with Montgomery. The British general was prickly, willful, vain, insensitive, and he had a much overnight tendency to claim the plans of others as his own, and at times took more credit for victories than was due to him. At the same time, Montgomery was an outstanding military leader, with a record in the war that few, if any, other Allied commander could match. Montgomery had already proved his caliber during the evacuation of Dunkirk in 1940, and in the brilliant series of victories in the desert of North Africa that began with El Alamein in 1942. Yet he was also capable of making unwise choices. Later on, in September 1944, he clashed with Eisenhower and the Americans over their broad front strategy and the narrow front, the single thrust into northern Germany, which he preferred. If Montgomery had had his way, U.S. General Patton's Third Army would have been robbed of supplies and support. Eisenhower put his foot down, and a broad front strategy prevailed. This, though, was not the first time Montgomery's tactics were called into question. 3 months earlier, his plans for capturing Caen became the subject of serious criticism. General Montgomery and Field Marshal Erwin Rommel, commander of German Army Group B, and his opposite number on the German side, were established rivals by the time their forces met in Normandy. They'd already faced each other in North Africa, where Rommel's dynamic style and talent for daring innovation had attracted the respect of his British opponents. At home in Germany, Rommel was tailor-made to be a war hero. Not only was he immensely likable, but the dominance in the desert he enjoyed until late 1942 and the way he consistently outwitted the British generated great excitement in Germany. The desert was pure battlefield, with few, if any, civilians and no towns or even villages, and Rommel was well suited to the fluid, fast-moving warfare this allowed him. But Normandy was completely different. Much more constricted, and even more importantly, much more under the control of Rommel's own supreme commander, Adolf Hitler. Hitler had never been all that keen on the desert war. The main reason he allowed it to continue was Rommel's popularity and the enthusiasm for the war it created at home. Rommel, however, had an invaluable trait for a Führer who always suspected men of ambition. He was a military commander, pure and simple, and had no yearnings for political power. If anything, he was politically naive, and that suited Hitler fine. Even so, it was a serious weakness for the German cause in Normandy to have military strategy in the hands of an incompetent like Hitler, who paid more attention to his own fancies than he paid to his commanders on the ground. Hitler's lack of military nous had already been responsible for the disaster that overtook the German armies in Russia. Rommel himself had been hampered in North Africa by the lack of military support Hitler had allowed him. Hitler knew nothing of the principles of strategic withdrawal and how it preserved forces to fight and possibly win another day. His answer to untenable situations was that Germans must never retreat, but fight to the last man. It was little wonder that the Führer was the despair of his generals, who had to follow orders, however impossible, and go on fighting battles and eventually a war they could not win. Rommel's glowing reputation preserved him from dismissal, Hitler's usual response to protest. But he was not spared the other drawbacks created by the Führer's scenario for Normandy. Once the Normandy landings had succeeded, The next task for the German defenders was to stop the Allies expanding the beachheads, and above all, prevent them from reaching Caen. It was clear that Caen was the next and logical target when a heavy air raid by 600 aircraft of the 8th US Army Air Force struck the town at 1500 hours on D-Day. Caen was transformed into ashes and smoking rubble. Meanwhile, out at sea, Allied ships sailed to town, covered in destruction. However, the delay experienced by the British in setting out from the coast to attack Caen gave them valuable time to organize an iron ring defense around the town. The Germans put three divisions in place to form three around Caen: the 21st Division, the 12th SS Panzer Hitlerjugend Division, and the Panzer Lehr. Their orders were to hold the line at all costs and put out such a barrage of fire that the British and the Canadians, who advanced towards Caen on the 7th of June, would find it impossible to penetrate. General Montgomery's strategy for Caen was largely conditioned by the plan to take the town on D-Day. His forces, therefore, were going to make a frontal assault. This, Montgomery expected, would take them through to Caen and past the supposedly weak and ineffective German defenses. Montgomery soon learned otherwise, as the fury of the German resistance began to decimate his forces. This led to a speedy change of plan for something more subtle and hopefully less costly. On the 9th of June, Montgomery conferred with Lieutenant General Sir Miles Dempsey and U.S. General Omar Bradley. They agreed that instead of a head-on assault, Caen would be enveloped, with the British Second Army keeping up pressure on the town, while pushing towards Villers-Bocage, Évreux, and then on southeast towards Falaise. Pressurizing Caen in this fashion would also serve to divert German attention from American effort to capture the important port of Cherbourg. By coincidence, the same day, Lieutenant General Leo Gerhard von Schleppenberg, commander of Panzergruppe West, unveiled a new plan of his own, a concerted push in which the three divisions shielding Caen would put out the Allied forces, and after the plan was amended by Rommel, recapture Bayeux from the British. What neither side could realize was that their plans cancelled each other out, with only one possible result: a direct clash all along the battle line. On paper, the balance of military capability in Normandy seemed to favor the Allies. However, in war, anyway, it is not necessarily the most mightily equipped or the most numerous side that prevails. Military capability depends on many more factors than this. The British and Canadian forces who opened the battle for Caen in the first week after D-Day were certainly well trained and well equipped, and their morale was high. Even though the Canadian troops were inexperienced, they drew extra motivation from the fact that they were volunteers rather than conscripts. Unlike the Germans, the Allied troops belonged to a force headed by a unified commander, with Allied dominance in the air to protect them, and a strong, if slow, build-up of men and armaments to reinforce them. These were important advantages, and ultimately, they were crucial. However, among the Allied commanders, there was a belief, endorsed by British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, that there were situations in which the Germans outclassed their opponents. Wherever Allied forces confronted the Germans in anything like equal strength, the Germans normally prevailed. Just how frequent that equality would be was an unanswered question as the battle for Caen got underway. On the Allied side in Normandy, the predominant tank was the American Sherman M4. A vast number of Shermans, 49,320, were constructed after production began in 1942. Making it the most abundant tank ever known. Compared to the British and some German tanks, the Sherman speed was high, 26 miles per hour, though at 31 millimeters, the thickness of its armor fell below that of most rifles. The Sherman, which weighed up to 32 tons and was powered by a 500 horsepower petrol engine, carried a 76 millimeter main gun, backed up by one 12.7 millimeter and two 7.62 millimeter machine guns, and a 2-inch mortar. It had a range of 100 miles and a fully transversible turret. There were drawbacks, though. The Sherman's profile was vulnerably high, and its armor was too weak to withstand much of the Germans' anti-tank fire. It was virtually helpless before the deadly German 88. After the critical loss of British armor and weapons suffered at Dunkirk in 1940, a replacement for the Matilda II tank was urgently needed. The first Churchill tanks were available within the year, by June 1941, but it took another 12 months to sort out the inevitable teething troubles. However, by March 1942, the 6-pounder gun was at last available to replace the less than effective 2-pounder carried by the first Churchills. After a disastrous victory during the raid of Dieppe in 1942, when the Churchills became trapped on a single beach, the tanks went on to prove their ability, particularly the ability to climb hills, in the North African campaign. Their maximum 102mm armour also proved relatively impervious to German anti-tank fire. The Churchills, which carried the 6-pounder main gun and two 7.92mm machine guns, were somewhat on the slow side, with a maximum speed of just over 15 miles an hour. In the air over Normandy, the most daunting sight of the German flight of Allied fighter bombers, clouding daylight guns, targets were often rotten and destroyed. This was why the Germans soon reported to the at night. One of the most prominent of the fighter bombers was the German special plane in the latter stages of the war as a tank buster. Typhoon started life as a fighter, but it tended to falter at high speeds, and its Sabre engine proved unreliable. As a result, the Typhoon suffered too many accidents to continue the long fighter role. Towards the end of 1942, the Typhoon was restructured and equipped with a new 2,180 horsepower Napier Sabre engine. The new Typhoon possessed a maximum speed of 412 miles an hour, a flight ceiling of 32,500 feet, and a maximum range of 510 miles. It carried a 1,000-pound bomb load and four 20-millimeter cannons. After its makeover, the fighter bomber re-emerged to become the terror of German warfare, and eventually formed the offensive spine of the 2nd Tactical Air Force. Though their bunker was deadly, the numbers were relatively small. 3,030 Typhoons were manufactured between 1942 and 1955. The Germans were classed as the underdogs in the struggle for Caen, and the Allies tended to presume that their military capability was in the same state. They were certainly very serious problems. The German 7th Army in Normandy was overstretched. They were constantly harassed by the French resistance. Air cover from the Luftwaffe was virtually non-existent. Losses were difficult, sometimes impossible, to replace. Allied air supremacy tortured the troops on the ground. On paper, the Germans seemed to have everything stacked against them. In fact, their military capability was much greater than this suggested. Many of the German commanders in the field were brilliant operational leaders, able to make the most effective use of their scarce resources. Some of them, like Major General Kurt Mayer, commander of the Hitlerjugend division, led from the front and personally inspired their men by their example. The long-standing German military tradition ensured that they were highly motivated, whatever the odds, and many of the German units comprised elite warriors who did not shrink from sacrificing themselves for Fatherland and Führer. If anything, they embraced it and equated such sacrifice with glory. The Allies considered this attitude fanatical. For the Germans, it was no more than their duty. The German 88mm flat gun, much in evidence in the battles around Caen, was one of the most powerful and most feared guns in the Second World War. The 88 was originally designed for anti-aircraft service. However, when some of them were converted as anti-tank guns and showed their destructive paces in North Africa in 1941, the 88's reputation as a fearsome destroyer was Normandy was the perfect setting for the 88. The Normandy blockade offered maximum chances for camouflaged 88 to lie in wait for opponents. It was a same as the many fortified villages where Army 88 was sighted. When mounted on the fighter tank, the very appearance of the 88 was startling. Allied troops described its 16-foot-long barrel as long as a telegraph pole. This unusual length made the muzzle velocity of the 88 extremely punishing. Firing at 85 degrees elevation, the 88 used armor-piercing fused shells that moved at 886 yards per second. They could hit their targets and create firebursts at distances of up to 2,000 yards. An experienced crew was able to dismount the 88 and be ready for action in no more than 20 seconds, then remount the gun to move elsewhere in less than 60. The Tiger II, or Panzer VI, was a tank equivalent to the 88mm gun, which served as an armament. Like the 88, the Tiger was a superior and a feared weapon. Because of the tank's exploits in Normandy, 14 of them were used by the Panzer Division. Allied troops came to believe that three Sherman or four Churchill tanks needed to challenge one Tiger. Then, the German tank would dispose of most, if not all of them. Designed as a heavy breakthrough tank to lead assaults by armored division, the Tiger II weighed a hefty 75 tons and was powered by a 692 horsepower engine with a maximum speed of 24 miles an hour. It was capable of piercing armor 112 millimeters thick at 1400 yards. The Tiger's own 110 millimeter front armor rendered it impervious to most of the Allied tanks and artillery. The exception was the British 17-pounder anti-tank gun, which appeared on the battlefield a month before the Tigers arrived. Even the Russian T-34 had to close to just over 1,600 yards before it had penetrated the Tiger's armor. Understandably, Allied tank crews generally preferred to outmaneuver the Tiger rather than confront it and approach it from the rear. Nurbelwerfer, meaning smoke thrower, originally applied to the German chemical mortar. Later, the Nurbelwerfer became a rocket launcher, specifically the 150mm 41 model, which had fixed launching tubes. Fired at ranges of up to 7,700 yards, the Nurbelwerfer 41 launched its incendiary rockets in sequence to avoid being overturned by the blast. Meanwhile, the Nurbelwerfer's crew had to shelter in a trench at least 15 yards away, and the rockets were fired electrically using a junction box. The full launch from the Nurbelwerfer, including loading, took 90 seconds to complete. The sound was terrifying, except for a high-pitched screeching. For the Allies, the Nurbelwerfer was a truly deadly weapon. It was reckoned to have caused three-quarters of the casualties among the infantry. For the Germans, the Nurbelwerfer helped them cope with the serious problem of infantry and artillery shortages in the latter part of the war. The Germans turned instead to massed Nurbelwerfers, which were especially effective in putting out defensive fire. General Montgomery gave the task of capturing Caen to the British Second Army under Lieutenant General Sir Miles Dempsey, who had at his disposal three armored divisions, seven independent armored and tank brigades, eight infantry divisions, and the Canadian First Corps. The infantry divisions consisted of some 18,400 men, combined from different regiments, together with an artillery brigade. An armored division possessed around 286 tanks, mostly Sherman M4s, and Cromwell tanks, and some 15,000 men. Divisions were apportioned into one infantry brigade, which had three motorized battalions, and an armored brigade of three battalions. There was also an infantry battalion which used half tracks. Close support for the infantry was provided by Churchill tanks, and by special tanks of the 79th Armored Division. Used by all sections of the British Second Army, these tanks were officially designated special purpose vehicles, but because of their eccentricity, they acquired the nickname. One of them was the flail tank, which was fitted with heavy chains on a revolving drum and was very effective in clearing demanding reaches of mines. Another of the funnies was the Churchill crocodile, which featured a flame projector in place of the hull machine guns. The role armies did not end with the Norman advancement. They were also used inland, where the Germans had sown a thick carpet of mud and armed. Given the savagery of the German defense, eliminating their strong posts and pillboxes by flame was often the only way. On the 7th of June, the 185th Brigade received a first taste of just how savage this defense was. Attempting to force their way through Libisi, northwest of Caen, they soon found that their powerful supporting batteries were not enough to prevent them from suffering huge casualties. The brigade's assault ground to a halt. The 9th Brigade did somewhat better at Caen, which they captured after the Royal Ulster Rifles caused death by traversing nearly a mile and a half of ground without cover. The Germans put up such a holocaust of fire that the Ulstermen suffered very heavy casualties, and the advance got no further. The 7th Army of Army Group B, whose task it was to defend Normandy, placed its strongest forces around Caen, leaving the coast to be protected by static divisions, filled in the main with men who were medically unfit, too old to fight, or prisoners from the Eastern Front, who'd supposedly volunteered for service with the Wehrmacht. The 21st Panzers, the Panzerwehr, and the 12th SS Hitlerjugend divisions, which placed an iron ring of defences around Caen, were much more elite forces. They were infused with self-sacrificing loyalty and the resolve and skill to fend off the Allies, no matter what the cost. One of these divisions, the 12th SS Hitlerjugend, the Hitler Youth, belonged to the Waffen-SS and comprised the most militarized teenagers in the world. Like the rest of the Waffen-SS, they were volunteers. Familiar with weapons since as early as the age of 6, the Hitler Youth had been reared for war and reveled in it. Despite, or perhaps because of, their extreme youth, the Hitlerjugend typified fanatical, last-ditch resistance more than any other German division in Normandy. Both the Hitlerjugend and the Panzerwehr had been thoroughly pounded by Allied air attack as it moved up towards Caen after D-Day. The Panzerwehr had left behind a trail of burned-out, bullet-ridden wrecks that included 130 trucks, 5 tanks, 84 guns, and the staff car belonging to its commander, Lieutenant General Fritz Bierlein. As an elite, however, the Panzerwehr had been given the most up-to-date equipment, including the incomparable Tiger II tanks and the Panther or Panzer V, which outclassed but did not replace the German Panzer IV tanks. The Hitlerjugend, whose full battle strength was 21,386 men, had always been treated as special. Later on in the Battle for Normandy, in mid-June, Adolf Hitler himself sought to preserve what was left of them by ordering their withdrawal. At that juncture, the parlous state of the Hitler Youth and the two other divisions displayed the grim truth about how they'd fought in the first week of the D-Day, and what it had cost them. The fighting at Libisi and Caen on the 7th of June gave notice that the early battles for Caen were going to be struggles to the death. This set a pattern that was to be repeated in every ferocious encounter that took place around Caen over the next 7 days. On the morning of the 7th of June, the 9th Infantry Brigade Group, the forward troops of the 3rd Canadian Division, were advancing towards Carpiquet and its airfield, which was sited west of Caen. Meanwhile, behind them, more Canadian tanks were moving southwest from the direction of Bouron and headed for Oti. The Canadians passed through Oti and set out for Fongville and Carpiquet. There was no apparent opposition, but it was there nevertheless. The progress of the Canadians had been observed all the way by the 12th SS Hitlerjugend Division, which was under orders to hold their fire until the right moment. Major General Kurt Mayer, leader of the Hitlerjugend, chose his moment carefully. He waited for the Canadian tanks to pass through Fongville and reach the point where they were just about to cross the road between Caen and Bayeux. Only then did he give the order to attack. Surprise was complete. Tanks were blown apart under close fire. The crews jumped out to save themselves, but ran into a hail of shot. Recovering, the Canadians returned fire, and a Panzer IV was hit. Flames funneled up out of its turret. Pushing through the smoke and thunder of combat, the Canadian infantry tried to force their way into Orsi, only to find the Germans waiting for them. In the subsequent melee, the Germans seized control of Fongsi and Orsi and started pushing back the Canadian forward units. The Canadians reeled under the impact, but the Germans didn't have it all their own way. Violent fighting raged all over the surrounding areas, and when the Hitlerjugend's 1st Battalion, which had been delayed by refueling problems, arrived in the suburbs of Caen, the Canadians were waiting for them with German tanks and heavy machine guns. The Canadian artillery opened up, and Allied aircraft weighed in with punishing bombing and strafing them. The Panzer IVs were outnumbered. They could do nothing to stop the Germans, and eventually, the Germans were forced to withdraw. After the furore of battle died down and the cost was counted, the Canadians came off worse. They'd lost 245 casualties and 28 German tanks. Although the Hitler Youth could congratulate themselves on their handling of the Canadian challenge, Kurt Mayer was not content to rest on these laurels. Early on the 8th of June, he ordered the 26th Regiment of the Hitler Youth to advance across the railway line between Bayeux and Caen, tackle the 6th Canadian Armoured Regiment, which had captured Brigade Jorgeux a few hours earlier. The Canadians were now poised to capture Papiquet Airfield, but the 26th Regiment got in the way, and the airfield remained beyond reach. Meanwhile, the 7th Canadian Brigade came under heavy attack at Bouton-en-Bessin. This prompted a speedy counterattack, with the Canadians making mammoth efforts to retrieve their positions. At 08:30 hours on the 8th of June, Canadian infantry and tanks put up a wall of fire with heavy machine guns and artillery. The 26th Regiment was caught without anti-tank weapons and had to pull back on the nearby railway line. At nightfall, Couture was back in Canadian hands. The pattern was much the same at Rocks in the Moon Valley, close to the Caen Bayeux Road, where Germans and Canadians killed each other at point-blank range. At Nory-en-Bessin and the Meniopatrie, in fact, all over the battle area. Whichever side managed to advance did so through a storm of counterattack fire. Attacks halted, resumed, halted again. Gains were made, lost, and retrieved. Here and there, tanks on fire blazed their flames into the sunny sky. Some of the crews burned to death inside. Dead soldiers slumped in ditches, or lay scattered across the field. This attrition cost the Canadians nearly 3,000 casualties in the first week of the Normandy campaign. Afterwards, they consolidated the positions that had been so dearly won, but got no further. After 4 days, General Montgomery was forced to realize that assaulting Caen head-on was futile. The casualties had been too great, and Caen was no nearer to being captured. The solution would not be easy, especially when Montgomery's new plan for enveloping Caen, finalized on the 9th of June, coincided with a German offensive decided on the same day. In these mutually opposing strategies, the British 50th Division and the 7th Armored Division, the Desert Rat, moving out of Bayeux to take Villers-Bocage, was going to be opposed by the Panzer Lehr, advancing from Villers-Bocage against Bayeux. In the centre, the Hitlerjugend were to advance north of the Caen Bayeux Road, and the Canadian 3rd Division would do the same in the south. The British 51st Highland Division, advancing out of the bridgehead east of the River Orne, was going to encounter the 21st Panzer Division moving into it. General Montgomery, appalled by the losses suffered so far, desperately wanted to avoid more of the same. In the event, more of the same was inevitable. The Panzer Lehr set off along the road to Bayeux, as ordered by Rommel. But they got within only 3 miles of the town when they were suddenly recalled. An emergency had suddenly arisen at Les Meniopatrie, a weak point in the German lines, where the Canadians were plastering the Hitlerjugend with ferocious crossfire. The Hitlerjugend, for their part, were answering back with heavy machine gun mortar fire. And eventually, the Canadians were forced to retire, leaving behind 37 tanks and 95 dead. As for Bayeux, on the 10th of June, the alternative German armour ordered to take the city ran into a powerful stream of Allied anti-tank fire and shelling of Royal. Royal Navy ships in the Channel, Bayeux remained in Allied hands. The Panzer Lehr were now ordered to defend the Pilis de Serbe against the British 7th Armored Division, which had advanced out of Bayeux. Pilis de Serbe, which was already in ruins by the time the Panzer Lehr arrived, lay in a valley to the southeast of Caen. This was no place for mobile warfare, but Bayeux ordered his countrymen in the army. The Panzer Lehr's tanks were then set up as mobile strongholds, heavily camouflaged and new, with only a small section of turret showing. Care was taken to obscure the marks their traps had made, as they moved into position so they wouldn't be spotted by the Allied forces. The Germans, meanwhile, hid themselves in ditches or in the ruins of nearby houses, and waited for the British 7th Armored Division to bring the battle to them. When the fighting got underway, it soon resolved itself into a series of vicious wounds. German machine gun fire spanked out of the conflict. British anti-tank fire thundered at the German position. There was a cloud of mortars, a hiss of flames, and here and there, the sharp sound of a single shot from a sniper. Every hedgerow, every ditch, a dangerous place for the British. Every easily clustered branches and leaves, a possible hideout for one of the deadly German enemies. Was also difficult and dangerous for the Germans. They were continually pounded by the Allied artillery and by mortars, and the hard, stony ground offered only shallow dugouts for protection. Nevertheless, the Panzer Lehr managed to hold up against the onslaught, and despite desperate efforts by the British to dislodge them, they clung on to their positions. What the Panzer Lehr could not do, however, was cover a weakness that opened up on their left flank between Colmar and Villers-Bocage. Here, there was a huge gap in the German defences, and at around 1500 hours on the 12th of June, the 7th Armored Division headed for it. Once they surged through, it was as if they'd passed through some sort of tunnel. For the first time since the Normandy landings, the way in front of the advancing British. Despite being held up by an isolated German outpost at Lille, where both the British lead tanks were destroyed, the 7th Armored Division arrived in Villers-Bocage at 0800 hours on the 13th of June. They were greeted by a massive and furious defeat, with a renewed liberation of the British drove on, straight through Villers, heading for Hill 213 on the high ground to the east of the town. From there, a major road led directly into Caen. What the British didn't know was that they were being watched from a small wood near Hill 213, and the man watching them was the last opponent they wished to encounter. 30-year-old Michael Wittmann was one of Germany's premier tank aces, and a daredevil who'd become something of a legend. In Russia, Wittmann had destroyed 6 T-34 tanks in a single day. By the time he left the Eastern Front, his total of kills stood at 119. Like many men of great daring, Wittmann was a loner. He frequently operated by himself and preferred to do things in his own way. For example, when he found the Tiger's rate of turret traverse too slow, Wittmann devised a method of swinging the whole tank round to face his opponents. At 0800 hours on the 13th of June, Michael Wittmann was in a position on Hill 213, together with 5 tanks, when reports reached him that British armour was arriving in Villers-Bocage. At once, Wittmann set out on foot for a small wood near the town, and from this cover, he watched the British arrive. It was soon evident that they had no idea that Wittmann or his tanks were close by. As Wittmann watched, they stopped for vehicle maintenance and breakfast. Wittmann had seen enough. He raced back to his tank and alerted his crew. There was no time to contact other tank units. Once again, Wittmann was on his own. He headed his Tiger down the hill towards the British tanks and half track, spraying them with machine gun fire at almost point-blank range. The first lightly armored British running tanks appeared. Victor fired at them with his 88mm gun, then swept past, heading for the center of the Temple Carnage. His next victims were three British Cromwell tanks. Next, running up against more British tanks, he backed up and was headed back for reinforcements when a Cromwell caught him and fired at two of his 75mm rounds. The shot same afternoon, Wichmann was back with two more Tigers, a Panzer IV tank, and more Panzer IVs poised to fire in support from Hill 213. This time, Wichmann destroyed an entire row of Cromwell and Sherman Firefly tanks, together with several Bren carriers. Wichmann sped on, heading for Vierre, but there the British had been thoroughly alerted, and he found the town very heavily defended. It was too much, even for Wichmann. Three of his four Tiger tanks were destroyed, and his own was brought to a halt when its track was blown off by a 6-pound British anti-tank gun. Two more Tigers were destroyed by Piat projectiles. Wichmann and his crew managed to escape, but they left behind them 25 ruined British tanks, 14 carriers, another 14 half-tracks, and several hundred British dead. That evening, the Germans were able to seize and hold Vierre Carnage. The damage Wichmann had done and the shock he'd administered at Vierre Carnage had serious consequences. The British drive to Caen, which had begun in such exhilarating need, had been stopped cold in its tracks, and the Germans had managed to close the last important gap in the battle line. Early on the morning of the 14th of June, the 7th Armored Division disengaged and withdrew to positions east of Caumont, 3 miles away. With this, a week after D-Day, the early phase in the battle for Caen came to an end. In the immediate aftermath of the early battles for Caen, both sides were utterly exhausted. The tank crews of the 7th Division were so tired, both physically and mentally, that many of them remained asleep throughout the withdrawal to Caumont and didn't even wake up when they reached it. The Germans, in particular the Hitler Youth, were in a similar state, but they at least had the satisfaction of some success. They had not only closed up their line, but defied all efforts to break through. Grievous casualties had been suffered on both sides. It was reckoned that the 6th Canadian Regiment alone had lost 1/3 of all their casualties in Normandy in a single engagement at the Menil Patrick. As for the Germans, one of their battalions, the 25th, was reduced from 700 officers and men to 539, and in the lull that followed Vierre Carnage, they lost a daily total of 1 or 2 dead and 12 injured and missing per day in the continuous naval and air bombardment. The Allies' failure to capture Caen in the first week of June 1944 was more than just a mote in the eye of the Normandy campaign. The town's strategic position and the role it played as guardian of the route east into Nazi Germany meant that it could not be bypassed or isolated, or simply marooned behind the lines of the Allied line. Even in its ruined state, the Allied air raid of 6th of June, when almost 3/4 of the town was destroyed, Caen remained the hook. Success or failure in Normandy hung. Plans for the American conquest of the Caen town and the subsequent breakout from the beachheads depended on its capture. A key component of General Montgomery's plan of attack had been to pin down the German armor at Caen to give the Americans a better chance. But the events of the second week in June had shown what it would cost and how much Allied defense would be diverted if this stance were maintained for long. By eating stone, the capture of Caen was not only the linchpin of Allied success in Normandy, but of the war in Western Europe as a whole. The questions, the doubts, and blame that arose out of the fighting around Caen after D-Day centered first and foremost on the overall plan devised by General Montgomery. Montgomery had never been an easy man to fight, which had many enemies, but the workings of personal feelings. not entirely explain why his plan came under so much criticism. Partly this was due to a certain inflexibility in Montgomery's style of leadership. Once a plan was made, he insisted on sticking to it. But doing that at round four had incurred unexpectedly high casualties. In the Allied ranks and officers' mess, severe doubts were expressed about the wisdom of Montgomery's strategy. No one seriously questioned the meaning of the victory of the Allied army, but was his plan for Caen the right one, and was it being executed in the right way? There was even talk that Caen had become an obsession with Montgomery, his personal only dread. If Montgomery had an obsession at all, it was his own unswerving self-discipline. Whatever happened, he always knew that he was going to be a from his wolf lair at Rastenburg in East Prussia, with no means of observing its reality. He promised Rommel reinforcements, but Rommel knew perfectly well that they would be under strength and under supplied. What Rommel really wanted was more personal control over his forces and the authority to order retreat as necessary. Hitler refused, but Rommel would not do that. Together with General Leo Gehr von Steppenberg, he flew to Rastenburg to confront Hitler. Rommel returned to Normandy still determined to change the confrontational tactics that he had imposed on him and adopt his stable principle of giving up ground for the sake of a more manageable defense. Rommel and von Steppenberg managed to receive the backing of their superior, Field Marshal von Rundstedt, but when he telephoned Hitler to put the proposal to him, he was summarily dismissed. The venerable Field Marshal was replaced by 62-year-old General Field Marshal Gunther von Kluge, whose view of Germany's war prospects was extremely pessimistic. Von Steppenberg was also replaced, and though Rommel survived, he was forced to accept Paul Hauser as a new chief of the 7th Army. Hauser, aged 64, had already retired as long ago as 1932, only to have his career reactivated after Hitler came to power the following year. Hauser had the same dismal view as von Kluge. He hardly helped the German cause in Normandy, or Rommel's handling of it. One of the most important command positions was now held by an old, demasticated soldier who had no faith in his chances of success. The struggle for Caen in the first week after D-Day had proved to be one of the bloodiest, most destructive, yet most inconclusive in the Second World War. But despite the agonizing over blame on the Allied side, and Irving Rommel's desperate attempt to give his forces better chances for defense, the battle was not going to change its nature. The imperative for the two sides remained the same. The Allies must take Caen. The Germans must prevent them doing so. And deciding which of them would.